My guest on today's episode is Sarah Christensen. Sarah is not only a good friend of mine, but she's also the founder of Kick-Ass Masterminds, which is a company that exclusively curates and facilitates mastermind groups for entrepreneurs, corporations, and their white label partners. Sarah is a gem of a human being, and she is joining me to kind of debut, really, a new feature on the Small Town Big Talk show called Hometown Visits, where somebody who grew up in a very small environment has now moved to a bigger community and they go back to visit. What do they experience? What do they learn to appreciate? Because one of the things that they can do for all of us that live in small towns is they can remind us of the cool things that we do have right in our backyard that we kind of forget. We see it and it becomes every day and it loses some of that specialness. And so she shares about her recent return to her hometown in Pine City, Minnesota. And along with all of that, which is beautiful, Sarah and I get into a lot of really cool tangents that I think are gonna provide a lot of value for you. We talk about how to bloom where you're planted. She shares some of the struggles that she had relocating to a different community. And even though it's not as small as a lot of the communities we might live in, the feelings that she felt are as palpable and real as what we have all experienced. So there's so much to take away from this episode. Enjoy this chat with my good friend, Sarah.
Sarah Christensen.
Hello.
I'm so excited for this. So you're my first person kind of doing this hometown visit. So to kind of give everybody a sense of where you started, where you went, and some of the things that you felt when you, because you just went back to your hometown, what, a few weeks ago, right? 2 weeks ago, maybe?
2 weeks ago, yes.
Yeah. And so just this whole idea of when you've been away for a while and you come back, what was that experience like? So can you give some context?
Sure, absolutely. So I grew up in this tiny town called Pine City, Minnesota. It's about an hour north of Minneapolis. When I was a kid, it felt like it was 10 hours out of civilization. And that this was a long time ago. I'm old. So I grew up there. Well, I was born in 72. So I lived there from 1972 until 1990 when I graduated from high school. And small town, when I was there, I think it was 2,300 people. And there's one stoplight. Now there's two, and there's a McDonald's. So it's like a metropolis now.
Yes, it is. Doubling your stoplights.
Exactly. That's a big deal.
Well, McDonald's is a big deal.
Yeah. It is a big deal. It is. But I couldn't wait to get out of there. I did not have a great experience when I was growing up in that small town. My experience was that so much of my status and my position in that small town was based upon my family. Uh-huh. And my family they were pretty rowdy and they were getting in trouble and not the bastion of respectable citizens. Let me just say that. So I definitely was judged a lot by that. And like I had a high school boyfriend whose parents wouldn't allow him to go to prom with me because I came from a bad family. Like that kind of stuff I dealt with. And I just wasn't into it at all. I just didn't want to be judged.
Right. I'm going to say, I'm sorry. I think that that's actually kind of common. I mean, you know, maybe not across the board, but especially if your family did. So was it generations of your family? Like how'd your family land in Pine City?
Yeah. So on my dad or my mom's side, my great grandparents moved there from, I think they lived somewhere around the metro area, but they moved there when they were like farming with horses kind of thing. They had been there a long time. And my mom's side of the family is the rowdy, crazy ones. My dad's side of the family, they're good, you know, middle-class people, but I was definitely judged by my mom's side of the family and generations of, you know, going to the tavern, getting drunk, passing out on the side of the road, that kind of stuff. And then when I was in seventh grade, I had a particularly traumatic thing happen. My birth grandfather, who I really wasn't connected with because my mom was adopted by her grandparents. So there was like a kind of a missing generation in there.
Okay.
But when I was in seventh grade, he killed his girlfriend in our small town. And so I was like, you know, I couldn't go to school. It was like the biggest news. Stop laughing.
Oh my God.
Hilarious and dramatic.
Well, it's horribly traumatic. And like, I mean, getting drunk and falling off of a bar stool. I mean, that's like typical small town rowdiness. Like I, you know, But killing somebody's not so much.
Oh, I know. Did you not know this story, this big drama story in my life?
No. That's why I'm like chuckling. It's not funny. Murder is not funny, friends. No. I'm not like making light of that at all. But oh my gosh, talk about stuff to overcome.
Yeah, but it is pretty dramatic. And so like I'm in seventh grade, which is awkward for any kid, right? I mean, that's like so awkward.
The worst.
Yes, the worst time. Worst and here years. My grandpa, who's a stranger to me, but nobody knows that, right? He's my grandfather. He was missing for a while. They had to, you know, catch him. And then it was a trial of the century in my small hometown. So there was a chunk of my seventh grade that I didn't even go to school. I was like, I can't deal with this on top of being an, you know, awkward 13-year-old. So I had a lot of that family karma that was dumped on me. And I wanted to get the heck out of there because right. of that. I didn't feel warm and welcomed. And like I had another kind of traumatic thing that happened that made me want to run out of this small town is my mom had four kids from four different men, which is controversial, right? Like pretty controversial in a small town. And when she wanted to get my brother baptized, they wouldn't baptize him in the church. So he had to do it in the luncheon area because there was no father involved. And I was like really upset about it that I said something to my Sunday school teacher. Or no, it wasn't my Sunday school. It was my confirmation teacher. And she kicked me out because I had the audacity to say, I don't think that was right. So like there were these traumatic things that happened to me that I could not wait to get the heck out of there.
Well, right. Yeah. And like, it's since I've only known you now for a few years, we've known each other for like almost 4 years, I think.
Yeah.
But obviously I've always known you as you are today. So it has always been inconceivable to my brain how you ever lived in a town that small, just because of, you know, who you've grown to be. And yet that is like, oh, and so anybody watching, like that is a really hard set of circumstances to overcome. I mean, for real, because we talk about this all the time, like in this context of small town living and like living big in your small town, like how do you really do that?
Yeah.
That's tough. Because no matter what, 2,300 people, everybody knows, I mean, everybody does know your business in a small town. It's kind of hard to avoid that. There's not enough of you to detract from, but
so when your
grandpa's running around doing legit dangerous and criminal things, that's kind of, talk about stigma. Holy cow, Sarah.
Yeah, for sure. So you can see why I pushed against it so hard. Oh. I was like, get me out of here. I don't want to participate in any of this like pettiness and judgment that I felt as a kid.
Right. And fair enough.
Yeah.
So then where did you go? What did you do?
So I was hellbound and determined to get out of there. So I got myself to college. So I was the first person in my family to go to college. So I went to St. Cloud State to go to college, which was still a smaller town. But for me, it felt giant, right? It felt like it was like this big, expansive area with all these stores and all these people. And from that point forward, I really was a big city person. I lived in Minneapolis. I lived in New York. I lived in San Diego. And a couple of years ago, we moved to Austin, which to me, based upon all that other experience and traveling I had done in my life, feels like a small town. So it's interesting that now I find myself in a smaller town than what I am used to, and quite frankly, what I was comfortable with. And that wasn't an easy transition for me. And honestly, I'm still kind of in it. And in figuring out how do I be happy in this place where, number one, I didn't choose to be here. So my boyfriend got transferred here for his work. So I didn't choose to be here. It's not necessarily where I would want to be, but we're here. Like it is. It's a fact. We're here. And how do I not be mad about it and complain about it, but to figure out how and where I can be happy. And again, I'm still in it, but I've kind of gotten to this point where I have to consciously choose that, because not doing that was making me miserable.
Right. Okay. So we're going to come back to that, because I think that is a huge theme of, well, you know, I mean, like when I speak to these women in small towns, this is what we talk about, because that is something I think a lot of people, unless you return to your hometown like me, you a lot of times are trailing, you're behind somebody, you're going with somebody. And I always say it's like these damn men, they're the ones that where they want to take us. But it is kind of true. A lot of times it's a spouse that's either relocating, like in your situation, or it's they're going back to farm, or they're going back to a family business. And and maybe you find yourself in a place where you didn't choose, and yet And you don't want to say that you're stuck there, because that's a mindset too, right? Like, I never say I'm stuck here.
Yeah.
But you're there.
Right.
And things don't feel awesome. So what do you do? So we're going to come back to that. First, let's talk about your visit back to Pine City. So
when's
the last time you were back home?
Maybe a year ago. And it's interesting because I have some family that's still in Pine City, but my closest family lives in the metro area, so Twin Cities. So my dad, my sister. So I have actually gone back to Minnesota and not gone back to Pine City, my small town, which is, that was kind of a weird transition too, because that always felt like that's my place. That's where my people are at. But like when my grandma's died, I didn't have a reason to necessarily go up there anymore. But so I hadn't been up there in about a year. It was at least a year. But we're having a birthday party for my dad, and he wanted to have it in the small hometown. We had it at the local VFW, which is such a, you know, small town thing to do.
Yeah.
And it felt, it always feels a little funky because I want to go see the, like, I want to go see our old house or my own, my grandma's house. And they look so sad and pathetic to me because no one's kept them up. And like my grandma and grandpa's house, someone didn't take care of it at all. It was just a hot mess, so much that they had to burn it down. So now it's just like the foundation. So it's kind of sad to see those places that I thought so fondly of. Like I used to think my grandma and grandpa's house was so fancy. I mean, it never was, but in my eyes it was.
Oh, totally. Well, and it was, you found love and family there, right? It felt like it was a home feeling about being there, right? Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. And so seeing like that place in disrepair, and then my mom, so my mom passed away, let's see, it's been about 17 years, to see her house just in disrepair. It almost feels like I don't want to go and revisit those places again, because it's taking away from the memories that I had. Like they're kind of eroded by the reality of today.
That makes me sad for you. But that's going to happen to me too. And I live right here with it. I mean, it does. My grandparents' farmstead was, they raised it, took it right down to the ground, you know?
Wow.
And yeah. So, I mean, I can't even visit it now. Like our commercial farm sits on it.
Yeah.
So put up all these fancy new buildings. It's like, God, it looks nothing like it did when I was growing up. It's weird. It is really weird.
It is weird. And it's weird when you, like we drove by the cemetery and saw my grandma and grandpa's gravestones, like all of that kind of stuff. That feels like time is going on when none of us have control over it, right? Like it's life is happening and stuff is progressing and all of this stuff is happening. And we have these memories of our small town and growing up and what that meant like and felt like. Like seeing my grandma and grandpa's gravestones reminded me of when I was a little kid, my grandpa had this giant black garbage bag full of like fake flowers, and I can still smell it. Like if I think about it, where we would go to the cemetery every year and he would drive the car and point out all the other gravestones, and I would hop out of the car and I had this screwdriver that I'd poke in the ground and make a hole and then put those plastic flowers in it. We did it. We had a giant bag of those fake plastic flowers. And then at the end of the summer, we'd go and pick them all up again. But just like remembering those kind of memories.
That's a cool memory, Sarah. And I think it's a very small town thing to do. So obviously with Memorial Day, having just been yesterday, super common. We go out to the cemetery and we visit all the people that we love that have died, you know?
Yeah.
And there's those flowers are everywhere in small town cemeteries. And I love that you have that memory of that. That's really cool. That's special. I mean, it's special. And I think, again, so that was one memory that like conjured up all of the stuff from the past. What else did you experience that felt that just true nostalgia? I had to explain that word to my 10-year-old. He's like, what does that even mean? We talked about it because nostalgia is such a strong, did you have moments when you were back?
Definitely had moments. So we went to the A&W, which is where I worked when I was in high school. And that was like my home away from home, because I started working there when I was 15 and I worked a lot. Mm-hmm. So it felt like, even again, the smell and the feel of the bag, all of that stuff, so much has stayed the same since I've worked there.
Yeah.
That I definitely get that hit. And that is one place I always, always visit when I go there, just to have that moment of remembering. And that was a happy memory for me. It was working there and gaining my independence and saving money for college and buying a car and all that kind of stuff. That was such a part of me growing up that I have such wonderful memories of that.
Yeah. I love all of my high school work experiences.
Uh-huh. Where did you work?
Well, I worked, okay, so I had a few jobs. So I was a waitress at our local diner. And like I was telling, I was having this conversation about kids today, which makes me sound very old because I say that now, like a little but just the idea that like, so for me, I really think working in as a server or in some sort of like that kind of food environment is really good for your ego, for humility. It's really good.
It is.
Like I served coffee to the coffee guys.
Oh, yes.
I've got my coffee cup here. Now imagine it's a good ceramic cup with a handle on it, right? I would be walking by and this is what they'd do.
Are you serious?
Just knock it on the table. And I mean, the first time it happened, I was only 15 as well. So the first time it happened, I remember I like stopped with the coffee pot and I thought to myself, is that my cue? Like, do you need something? And I turned around and they didn't all do that, but there was a couple that's what they did. They knocked it on the table. And yeah. So to get over yourself, swallow that, just like, oh, I've got things I want to say to you, mister. But
yes,
like not to top it off too full and spill a little on his hand, you know, just yeah, kick.
Sorry.
So yeah. So I worked there and I was a telemarketer.
Whoa.
In a telemarketing firm in Oaks. That was a terrible job. I mean, but so funny. And I had such good memories from that too. Worked at a pizza ranch and I was a lifeguard.
Oh, that's such a small town thing.
Isn't it? Yeah. So you had the twirling of the whistle down like Pat. Like we still talk about my good friends. Some of my best friends worked there with me. It was really fun. Yeah.
So fun. Yeah. All those like kids working kind of experiences in a small town is so great because the businesses are part of the community, right? Like you're part of what's going on. And right. So many of them are locally owned. Like the A&W was a franchise, obviously, but the local Birchin family owned it. And I knew the whole family. And it was just, for me, it was my first vista into business. And I ended up being a business owner. So I look back on those experiences as my start to, you know, pushing me to go to college and to learn the things and to start businesses. I'm so grateful for that experience.
Me too. And I think now coming back, I think very differently about business and kids and how, you know, how we build, because I think it also in a small town, it helps create community pride. It's a clear way that we integrating students. And I think, doesn't it somewhat factor into the way that you think about who you hire?
Oh my gosh. Business, yes.
Right.
100%.
Like hiring people that are local to you, if possible, there's so much value to that.
So much. Well, and you and I, we talk about business all the time, and I just did hire a full-time marketing person that lives here in Austin, and I could have hired someone that worked remotely, but for me, it's important to build a business that's based here. And part of that is the people and the community. Right. And so being able to hire locally, and I've done that with most of my businesses, is hired people locally because I wanted to have that foothold. And I think there's a lot of value to that, especially in the world today where so much is digital, so much is virtual. Mm-hmm. I think so that's obviously a giant trend, right? But I think there's a counter trend to that where people want face-to-face. They want local. They want community. They want connection because as wonderful as a lot of this digital stuff is, it's not the same as looking in someone's eyes and giving them money for a service or a product that they're providing for you. I mean, I find myself seeking out small businesses and shopping locally as much as I can. I cannot stand the homogenization of our retail and of our restaurants and all of that. Like chain restaurants are not my jam at all. I'm always looking for where's the local place? Where are the people who are, you know, feet on the ground kind of thing. They're for me, that's really important. I value that a lot.
Oh man, I do too. And I think, so, you know, you and I've been friends for a while, like when Shopko closed, right? That was our big retail. That's because there isn't much opportunity for those. They're non-local owners, right?
Yeah.
Somebody somewhere in another state or city is making all of the decisions. They're so far removed from me or my family and my kids. And that's where I really do. I agree that I don't think there's ever been a better time to consider starting a locally owned business.
Yeah.
You're in your own neighborhood, right?
Yeah.
And it's not, of course, it's not easy. Retail is retail. But like, I think about our hardware store, they happen to be good family friends of ours. The the commitment and the care and the concern and the attention to detail, and it's incredible. Like the way that they can serve us, Shopko couldn't, because they it doesn't matter even how they had local people working there, right?
Yeah.
But their whole service model is just more removed. And I do think people are looking for that high touch, like you said, eyeball to eyeball kind of service.
Yes. But it has to be unique, right? Because the thing that I didn't have when I lived in a small town that you have right now is you can have stuff delivered, right? Like you can have Amazon delivered, you can have Walmart delivered, you can have, you know, Banana Republic delivered, all that kind of stuff. That just, and you can shop online and you can have access to anything in the world. I mean, that's the reality, no matter where you
live. Yep.
So small town businesses can compete on that kind of commodity stuff. They need to have something that's different and that's experiential and that gives people a reason not to just shop on Amazon because they're saving 50 cents on that product. But that's the cool thing, is that there's so many opportunities. Like I think about the movie theater here. There's a movie theater in Austin called the Alamo Draft House. We see 95% of our movies there because it's an experience. They serve wine, they serve beer. The ads before the movies are super funny. They have really comfortable seats. Like the whole thing is an experience. It's not just that commodity. So I think there's so much opportunity for people to start businesses in small towns that have that unique experience, that have the relationship that's beyond just the commoditized stuff. Yeah.
Yeah, the goods, whatever the goods are. Totally, totally agree. And I think we've got some awesome examples of people that do that here, which is really cool.
So good.
Yeah. It's really neat. So, okay. So you stopped at the A&W. Where else did you go that you felt a bit of nostalgia?
Yeah. So we drove by some of our old houses, which was interesting. We stopped at the beach. So I wasn't a lifeguard, but I definitely spent time at the beach. So that was kind of interesting because, again, as a kid, I viewed it as such a big deal, right? Mm-hmm. Like I had my first kiss underneath the raft after I could finally swim enough to get out to the raft, which was a big deal, you know?
Well, you were working on getting that. You're like, hell yes, I'm going to put in the effort to learn how to swim out there. My boy is waiting under a raft. God, that's
exactly under the raft. Yes. And I can still remember what his swim shorts looked like. They were like plaid Bermuda swim shorts, but they were kind of like these different patchworks of plaid. Like I can see it vividly.
That is awesome.
Isn't that funny? So funny. And well, at the VFW, it was interesting too, because since this was my dad's 70th birthday party, all of these people from my past were there. Mm-hmm. All of my dad's friends and like his friends' kids who I grew up with. So that was an interesting thing, because in that one experience, I had all these people from my life there and like reconnecting with some of them I probably, honest to God, haven't seen in 30 or 40 years.
Right. So did you feel, did the judgment, the fear, the feeling of judgment, did it come back? Or did you do a lot of work to prepare your heart ahead of time and mind?
Well, the people that were there weren't the people that were judging me. Those were my dad's friends. Those weren't the judger. So for me, the judgment came in our town. The teachers were the big deal. Like if you were a teacher or you were a teacher's kid, they were kind of the upper societal echelon, or there were some people who like owned a nursing home, some of the bigger businesses, they were kind of in the upper echelon. We definitely were not socially. So I wasn't worried at all about seeing my dad's friends or any of those people, because they were kind of dirtbags like us.
Well, that's okay though, right? I was just wondering, because I think sometimes that's the feeling. Well, like, you know, my 20-year class reunion is coming up. And it always makes me wonder what people are thinking and feeling. Like, is it a big, are you doing prep work in your head? Obviously, I don't have that right now because I moved back here. But still, definitely, there's a lot of weird energy around it. You know, seeing everybody, and is it going to be easy? Is it going to be awkward? Is it going to be, you know, what's it going to feel like?
Yeah.
It was a party that you had kind of orchestrated. You were probably, you know,
we planned it and we knew who was going to be there. But I did go to one of my high school reunions, and the thing that where I've traveled to just personally with reconciling all of this is I'm not that kid that I was when I lived there. I'm not the victim of my family's circumstance. Like I have been really successful. I'm happy. I like who I am. And so when I go into those situations, I don't pick up that up anymore. Like I've left that behind and I've had to do some work around it. And in a while it still comes up. Like once in a while I still get that like welfare kid mentality or small town, like judgment mentality. Sometimes that still will crop up. But for the most part, I've done so much work about it that I actually appreciate being in those situations because I can remind myself, like I don't have to pick up anyone's judgment. And right. I've ascended beyond being that kid that felt so crappy and felt so judged. Like I'm not available for that anymore. And so when I go back there, that's kind of to me, it's another touch point of this. That was who I was when I was there. And I'm not that same girl anymore.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I think what's interesting is that if all of us were honest, anybody in any, like, regardless of the size of the community you live in, hopefully everybody has evolved.
Yeah.
In some way, shape, or form, right? Because no matter what, like life happens, things happen. You know, like you said, your mom died. That's one of those major earth shifting, life shattering kinds of events, right? Where yeah. you can't come out on the other side of that not changed in some way, shape, or form. And so I just feel like everybody does that, but it grows and evolves and changes. But I sometimes think that it can be really easy to get stuck back in that pattern. But like, I love what you said, because I've said this to people. People can throw whatever they want at you. It's your choice yeah. if you want to pick it up and carry it. Let them drop it right at your feet. Look down at it, see it there, and go, huh, look at that. I don't have to pick that up. You don't have to pick it up. Just choose not to pick it up. And then it won't be a burden for you to carry, you know?
It's so true. Well, and what I tell myself a lot in those situations is, what they think about me isn't my business. Mm-hmm. That's not my business at all. I don't, you know, that's on them. That's about them. It's not about me. Right. So even like in life today, if I feel that kind of judgment, it's like, this is about you. It's really not about me. And that's not my business to care what you think about me. And it's taken me a long time to get there. Again, especially coming from a small town where I felt like everything that I did was so incredibly judged. Everything was so judged that being able to drop that and to say, it's not my business what you think about me. You can keep that.
Right.
And think whatever you want. I don't care because it's not my business.
This is why this is a huge theme in my, especially one of my keynotes where I talk to these women, right? And we talk about this exact thing. Because I think fear of judgment is the thing that likely holds most of us back in smaller
towns.
So
true.
Right?
So true. Anywhere, honestly, right. anywhere, yes. But a small town is just a microcosm of it, right?
Yep. And now petri with social dish. Media,
yeah, it is a petri dish, mm-hmm. but we all have it, especially now because of social media. But in the small town, because it's such a small, you know, this small environment, it feels intense.
It is intense sometimes. Absolutely. And so all I talk about now, and the whole thing is like, this is a different conversation. You almost can't get there when you're a young kid.
No.
Like you were young. You were, there was like a million ways that you were still developing and growing and learning. And you're like on top of it, still in the thick of it. I don't know that there's, not to say that there's not conversations. I'm going to be having these conversations with my kids, right? As I raise them. But they're still going to have to go through their own shit. This is that's what growth is, right?
It is.
But now when you come back, like, you know, so we're going to talk about Austin now, how you kind of, this feels similar to you in Austin, even though like by the people that are watching this would be like, Austin, that's not small. But again, small is relative though. I mean,
it is,
it really is. And so I think though that in these women that are in small towns, to be able to nurture and find one good friend that can completely hold you, whether you're celebrating, because I talk about like, we don't want to celebrate because we don't want to look like we're bragging on ourselves. So all the crap of wherever judgment can come in, usually it's on one of two ends, either celebration or you feel like crap about yourself. Right. Yeah. And you don't know where to have that conversation. You need one. And they don't, ideally they're in your small town, but even if they're not, there are a million ways to stay connected to people, which that's the beautiful thing about social media, right? Like that's what I love, is being able to stay connected. But day to day though, just saying like, look, you can think what you want. That has nothing to do with me and I'm not picking it up.
Yep. It's so true.
Really good reminders for all this. Please do. Yeah.
Okay. So I did have one of these epiphanies when I was in high school. We had,
oh, did you?
We had a driver's ed teacher who was a creeper. You didn't want to get him for driver's ed because you were alone with him in the car, and he was a creeper. And he was running for school board or something like that. Well, my friends and I, because he was such a creeper.
I almost said, as all creepers do, which I don't mean. My husband was on the school board. My husband served on the school board. I'm kidding.
We thought it would be a great idea to pick up all of the yard signs that he had put out for his campaign and have a bonfire, which we did.
Oh, and
we got in trouble. Someone, you know, told on us or whatever, and we all got called down to the principal's office. And I remember feeling like he's a creep, and we responded to his creepiness because that's the only way, any recourse we had. Like, girls had told on him, nothing had happened, and I felt somewhat justified to that we were like these vigilantes that took it into our own hands. And I never picked up on any of the judgment. I honestly didn't feel bad about it because I felt like it was our only way to stand up for what was right. Yeah. So my constitution is about what's right and what's true and what's honest. And that is so important to me. And so I felt that in that moment, like, even though it was in the newspaper, right, the weekly Pine City, we call it the Pine Poker, even though it's called the Pioneer. I don't know why we call it the Pine Poker, but my dad reads me snippets from it every once in a while still. But even though it was in there, and, you know, I think we had to go to court, we had to pay back this money, all this stuff, I didn't feel any judgment around it because, again, I felt somehow justified in standing in our truth, that that was our only recourse around that. So I think even if you're in it, not picking up on some of that bullshit judgment because you feel so strongly and convicted about it can be a way to work through it. Now, I'm not encouraging vigilanteism here.
Right.
But if you feel strongly about something, whether it's celebrating a victory that you've had or sharing a struggle, like, I think if there's strong enough emotion and conviction behind it, that is such a help to not pick up on the judgment, because it's almost like you feel so strongly about it, doesn't matter what anybody else says, because you are so anchored in that emotion and that feeling around it, what people say about you or about it, it doesn't even matter. It doesn't even faze you. And that's how I felt in that situation.
Strength of conviction can go a really long way.
Yes.
Because, I mean, I think about, okay, so in our small town right now, like, we've got some older systems, I guess I'll say it, like how things get done. The systems are kind of, they're just entrenched, maybe, way to put it. And if you want to challenge that in any way, the strength of your conviction, it has to, I mean, you really can't be you can't falter, you can't waffle, you can't be fickle. And I mean, it is very hard if you're especially going to go against the grain and stand up for something that you really believe in. And yet if the strength is there, it really can help to just be like, this is what's right. This is what's true. This is what needs to be said or needs to be done. Yeah,
exactly.
That's a great story. Right. And we'll repeat, we're not encouraging vigilanteism in any of our communities. Please don't burn things down.
No. Well, and remember, this is probably 1987, so girls were not necessarily listened to.
Oh.
They weren't in our school when this stuff was going down. So, you know, it's not, I wouldn't recommend it, but it felt like our only recourse to have somebody pay attention to what was going on.
Right. You got your own form of justice.
We did. And honestly, nobody got hurt.
Right.
And he still won a seat on the school board, so there.
Yeah. But you still felt good burning his signs, and I think that's all right. Like you said, you didn't hurt anybody.
Nope, we didn't.
You didn't murder anybody. That was exactly. That was your grandpa.
I did not. I
cannot believe.
We are forever going to laugh our asses off when we talk about this terrible story, aren't we?
I know. Well, I just, like, obviously I was very shocked. And then I inappropriately laugh at it, which is like, oh my gosh. Oh my goodness.
You know what? I have learned that with some of the craziness, especially with my family, if I can look into it from the outside and think about it like a movie, it is hilarious. If I don't allow myself to get injured by being in it, there is some really funny shit. And that is funny. I mean, that is a funny, crazy story. Like, who does that happen to?
Right. But that's just it. And yeah, so I do the same thing. Like, if things get really heavy and really hard, if you can back all the way up and watch it like it's a movie, and then think of what would I title it? Like,
yes,
all the way there. Like, it's a Lifetime movie. What would we call this? You know,
totally.
Then it's really kind of humorous.
It is kind of humorous. Yes. And I think a lot of things that happen in my life, I love the Coen brothers, who are also from Minnesota. Like, mm-hmm. they tell all these kooky, crazy stories. I'm like, they could totally produce some of this, these stories from my life, because it's that same crazy, kooky genre.
And it's dark. It's like dark humor.
Yes.
Funny, but it's really dark. Yeah. Oh, that's great. That's
so
great.
True.
Okay. So
I'm sorry. I off-tracked us.
No. It's good. We're fine. We off track on the show. This is
okay.
So let's talk about Austin.
Yeah.
Let's talk about, because I think, you know, when you and I were chatting a little bit beforehand, the torch that I'm trying to carry for women, like I want to just keep passing the message on, is that you don't have to feel stuck. And you don't, and I also feel like compromising isn't the same as settling. That is, because again, so many of the women that I talk to and work with are in a small town and they're married or they're in a committed relationship and there's a tie keeping them there.
Yeah.
So how do you move through that, especially if you're not feeling like you're digging where you're at, right? These are, this is challenging feelings. And because the conventional wisdom is like, well, just up and move.
Yeah.
Well, you know, it's like, I want to give you the double barrel. Like, thanks for nothing. Because I, like me right now, land. We farm land. And land isn't something you pick up and move. So I have had to dig really deep. That's kind of what my whole life's work is about, is how to, you know, continue feeling like me, regardless of the size of my environment. So blooming where you're planted, I think, is really something that everybody can benefit from hearing. So what has that looked like for you when you transitioned to Austin from San Diego?
Well, for a long time, I was fighting it. I was spending my time complaining about how crappy it was here, how it didn't have this and it didn't have this, and any opportunity to point out something that was crappy, like, I was on it. I was totally on it. So I think I really honest to God think I had to go through a grieving process mm-hmm. to grieve the fact that we're here and I'm consciously here. Like, I've made a choice. I want to be here with Scott. This is a in my head choice that we made, but I was still fighting it. And I was the one that was suffering because of it. Austin wasn't changing because I was complaining.
Yeah, right.
It wasn't changing because I was bitching about it. It was carrying on with its own fine self. And I was the one that was being tortured. Like, I was self-torturing myself. And honestly, it's just recently that I've started to consciously choose to focus on the things that I really do like about here. Like, there's a restaurant, coffee shop that I love here. There's nothing like that in San Diego. I go there all the time because I know that's a place that makes me happy. And I know I need to be in that environment and I really like it. And now I've started to, so in San Diego, it felt like we could just any day find something really cool to do. Here in Austin, it's not like that. We have to look forward a little bit more. So I've been doing that. Like, I've been looking forward. What are the events that are coming? Buying tickets to stuff, getting them on my calendar. So it just needs to be more purposeful than what I was used to and what I was experiencing. So that's one thing that I've really shifted, is I am going to seek out and find the good stuff. It's not going to come slap me in the face like it used to. It's not just going to come at me, but I have to seek it out.
Right.
And that's okay. Like, I'm okay with that. The other thing that I had to realize is this town isn't everything for me, and that's okay. I can go to other places to get the things that I want. Like, there's no art museums here. Beyonce's never going to come in concert here. There's no professional sports teams here. Things that we love and want to do. And we've just made a commitment that when we need that, we're going to travel and get it. Mm-hmm. And that's okay. Like, I went to New York with Scott on a business trip and I spent 3 days in art museums. Like, I'm full. I'm good for a while. I don't need to go to an art museum every single day.
Right.
But seeking those things out to fill up what's important to me, and just to realize and know and accept and be okay with the fact that it's not all here, and that's okay.
I think that's super important for rural small towns. Because I think that the thing I hear a lot is that nothing ever happens in these small towns. Like, there's not anything to do. Well, maybe not day over day, you know, like every single day you don't just walk out on the streets of your small town and there's like some awesome thing happening. No, that doesn't happen at all. But I don't think that we frequent the stuff that does come enough. We don't like put it on our calendar. We don't look ahead. We don't plan for it. Yeah. And it's like, take advantage, right? Take advantage of the opportunities that are there. And
For sure.
It is just a mindset, right? To actually plan, schedule it. Don't
Exactly.
Wait out when the thing actually comes. Make sure that you're actually taking the time to do those things. And again, you're only doing it if it fills you up.
Yeah, it's, you know, so it's true.
Filling that void.
And looking for that stuff, maybe even outside of your community.
Right.
Like, we're willing to drive to go places too. So I always look within like an hour radius, and we have some other cities that are fairly big that are close to us. So we can always drive and travel to those cities. An hour in the car is not that big of a deal. And there's cool stuff that happens all around. And, you know, the other thing is, in terms of things to do, because that's one of the things that I've struggled with too. Like, I'm not kidding you. There was a Sunday a couple of weeks ago where we were looking for something to do. So we're looking on all the, you know, websites and the newspaper and all that stuff that has the events to do. And Austin is a big foodie city. So everything's about drinking and everything's about eating. And we didn't want to go do that.
Food trucks,
all that stuff. Mm-hmm. One of the things listed, I'm not kidding you, is chicken shit bingo.
What's where chicken shit bingo? Where there's
literally a big like bingo board on the ground, and they put a chicken in there, and wherever the chicken poops, that's what they call out.
Fantastic.
Yes. Yes. And I was like, oh my God, we live in this place. And I was kind of bitching about it. And Scott's like, that's awesome. Let's go. So we're actually going to go on Father's Day. That's where we're taking him for Father's Day.
Chicken shit bingo. By the way, this is totally going to get teased as part of this episode. Like, I'm just you want to know what chicken shit bingo is? Watch this episode. Like, oh my gosh. But that kind of stuff, irreverent,
yeah,
weird kinds. Well, Austin, like that's your city motto, right? It's like stay weird, right?
Yep.
Is that the city motto?
It is, yeah.
Yeah. I've said this before too. Like, maybe something that's listed doesn't at first glance appear to be your thing.
Yeah.
Right. But what if you took a chance on it? Because honestly, for me, some of my favorite memories that I've made with like good friends, you know, you find one other couple, let's say, or maybe it's just you and your significant other, and you go and you have like, you see things that are unexpected. You laugh really hard. You make memories. Like, sometimes we just have to get out of our own way, I think, is part of it, right? Like, energetically get out of your way.
Yes. And try new things. I mean, if you're feeling stagnant in your place, you got to try things that you've never tried before. Like, part of my integrating into the city is I haven't found exercise places that I like to exercise. So over the next couple of weeks, I'm trying like 5 or 6 different exercise things that I've never tried or never done before. Cause I'm just trying, I know I need to solve that. And I've just been bitchy about it up until this point, but now I'm like, I'm just going to solve it. And the only way to solve it is by trying a bunch of things I've never tried before. And some of them will be awkward and some of them I won't like. And I'm willing to go through that to find the one gem in there. Cause mm-hmm. that's what I'm looking for, that life. I'm looking for that energy, but we can't find those things if we just stay at home and watch Netflix and Hulu.
Right. Although I love that too.
Well, I do too.
But you're so right. And I think a few times we've talked about on the show, just the kind of the theme of leaning into the discomfort.
Yeah.
Cause it is uncomfortable. And it's so easy to go, well, if I was just back in San Diego, I wouldn't feel like this. And then completely yes. bemoaning where you're at, instead of honestly looking at it like a bit of an adventure. You know, like
yes.
this is exploration. Yay.
Exactly.
Trying new things, meeting new people.
That's
and,
exactly right.
The other thing too, is I always say this to people, you could meet one amazingly rocking cool person, like make one really, really cool, just amazing new connection, but that won't happen if you don't put yourself in the way of that to happen, right? You've got to leave your house. That's you've got to try things. You've got to go places.
Yes. It's true. Well, and you have to be open to other humans, even though you might have judgments against them or preconceptions about them. Because let's face it, all of us who live in small towns have those things about the others that are there, right? It's like we all have those kind of things, but your belief about them may or may not be true. And being, I think, brave enough and courageous and open enough to talking to people to get to know them and to see what they're all about. And I would submit that a lot of the preconceptions probably aren't true and that they are probably more like you than you think. But I'm just thinking about like in my small town, even some of the people that I reconnected with at my dad's party, there were some things that came up that I was like, well, that is interesting. And that's that I wouldn't have expected that from you. Like,
right.
But I had to talk to them to get that.
Right. Yeah. And finding common ground Well, that's just a really important interpersonal skill, regardless of like,
yeah,
no matter what it is that you're doing, but even just making the attempt. And like you said, that, so with that comes some discomfort a lot of times, you know, and just like, ugh, I don't, people, new people, or maybe it's people, maybe you're going back to, like for me coming back here.
Yeah.
So many belief systems that got challenged once I started to really get to know people, right?
Interesting.
Like I had so many preconceptions about who people were, what they thought, what they'd think of me.
Yeah. Right?
And all of that, ultimately, it's like, give people a chance to be who they actually are and have evolved into.
Yeah.
Instead of holding kind of a rigid idea of who you think they are based on.
So true.
Yeah. Time goes by. People change. Things happen, you know?
Absolutely. Oh my gosh. It's so true. It is so true. And the other thing I'd like to offer is that if people want to have something different, there's no reason why you can't create it. Uh-huh. One of the things I saw when I went back to Pine City, there was a big banner. They have this place where they hang banners over the road where they promote festivals or whatever's happening. And there was a banner for an LGBTQ party in the park in my little small hometown.
Wow.
And I was like, number one, somebody created that, right? Somebody who was in that community, who was in that, in the Pine City, in that community, wanted to have an event that they could connect with other people who were in that. So somebody wanted that. And number two, they actually did something about it. Like, good for them in this small town where they are probably not going to necessarily be open with, you know, with wide welcoming arms by everyone. They were brave enough to do it anyways. And I'm, and what's funny is when my grandma was alive, she would go to that picnic because my brother is gay. So even though my grandma wasn't gay, she wasn't, you know, wasn't part of the community per se, she showed up in support and solidarity for that. So I think that there's an opportunity to even pull other people out of the woodwork that might have common interest, the same common interest that you do, and you don't even know that they're out there.
Right. Thank you for adding that, because I was going to ask your take on that, because I do think we can sit back and we can wait for the things we need and want to be hand-delivered to us, or we can start figuring out how to bring it or create it ourselves. And that, those are some of my favorite people to interview on the show, are people that did that, that said, I want this in my small town, or I want to feel this way, so I'm going to figure out a way to make it happen.
Yep. It's so cool.
There's no limit to what we can do. I mean, seriously. And like you said, it doesn't have to be for everybody. You don't have to be for everybody.
Nope.
But you know what? If you're clear about what it is that you want, what it is you're trying to create, who is welcome, the right people that do feel that are going to be so grateful that you created it for them.
It's so true. It's so true. And no matter if you live in a small town or a big town, everyone is, there's so much difference in terms of what you like to do and what turns you on and what makes you excited. But there's other people out there who want and feel that too. So whether it's five people getting together to do that or 50, it really doesn't matter. It's just creating that space and that container to do what lights you up, and knowing that if you put that out there, other people will also show up. They really will.
Right. Yeah. Okay. So with all of this, this is one kind of final thing that I like to ask. So like my whole theme is living big, right? Living big in a small town. When you think about being in Austin now, like, and that's your small town, which again, everybody watching this would be like, really? Like, she has multiple places to go visit for fitness? What?
Yes, okay. I know.
I'm not judging. It's good, because the feelings are the feelings. And that's why, like I say, this is a relative thing. What does living big look like for you now in the place that you're in?
Yeah. Well, for me, it's doing the things that make me feel like I'm alive and make me feel delighted and make me feel happy. And I know that I could do those things whether I live in Pine City or I live in Austin or I live in New York City. I know that there's either things that I can tap into or things that I can create, because I know what lights me up and I know what makes me happy. Like, I love dancing. It is like my number one jam. And so I've sought out the places here. And on Saturday morning, I take this hip hop dance class. I'm for sure the oldest person in the room. I don't even care. It's ridiculous and awesome and amazing. And that makes me feel happy. Like, that lights me up. That fuels me. So knowing what makes you happy, and I think that's not an easy thing always either, right?
No,
especially for women, especially for moms, because a lot of times we're not focused on our happiness. We're getting through life and we're taking care of babies and we're working and all those kinds of things, but just figuring out what is that thing that lights you up? Like, did you play sports when you were in high school? Did you like theater and drama? Like, what are those kind of things that make you feel like you're alive, right? That make you feel giddy and alive. And how can you bring more of that into your life? Whether you're tapping into things other people have created or you're doing that yourself. I mean, the reality is the dance class that I love is by this woman named Melody. It's called Melody Dance Fit. She has an online program. So if I lived in Oaks with you, I could still do her dancing program on Saturday morning or any damn time I wanted to. That's the amazing thing about right now. So you can tap into anything. So figuring out what's going to light you up, bringing more of that into your life, and knowing that there really aren't limitations around that. We create the limitations, and if we can peel some of those away, there's so much lightness and joy waiting for us on the other side of that.
Oh my gosh. I just want to like bring you on the road with me. This is what I think about life. Like, that's so beautiful, Sarah. And I think that's exactly, I mean, that's what living big looks like to me as well. And I think the nail that you hit on the head is the idea that that we just go through life knowing exactly who we are and what we want to do. That's work too.
Yes.
I mean, but like good work and not like slogging work, but you've got to be willing. That's where you've got to be willing to like step out potentially. And it feels kind of icky out there and you're going to wait around and go, oh, is this me? Is this not? But when you find either the people or the things or the ideas or the experiences that do create that delight, I measure that by heart swells. I think I've said that to you guys before, like that feeling of your heart just like exploding. I love that feeling so much. Then you're like, I'm onto something. Yes. And then it's just a matter of how do you create easy, simple ways to weave that into your life.
It's so true. And easy, simple ways could even be things like putting on cute clothes in the morning. Right? Instead of schlumpy clothes, like there's easy, simple things that all of us can do no matter where we're at to bring those pieces of joy into our lives. I mean, like I think about my mom, I used to buy her nice stuff, but she never wore it because she felt like it was for a special occasion. And then she died and I found it all, right? Like she held that stuff back because she was waiting for a special occasion. What she wasn't living in is the fact that every single day is a special occasion. And if we're not in it and immersing ourselves in it, nobody else is going to do that for us. So you need to, you know, wear the cute clothes. You need to splurge and go to that concert or take a weekend away or whatever it is, because there's no there, right? There's no there that any of us are getting to. We need to get about it today.
Right. There's not going to be a better time.
No.
Like for whatever it is that you want to do, we tell ourselves that. Like it'll be a better time in September. It'll be a better time when the kids are, you know, when all my kids are in school, then it'll be a better time. There is no better time.
No.
It's the best time. The time right now.
It is so true. Very true.
Oh, Sarah, thank you so much. God, I love talking to you.
Thank you. This was fun. It was fun for me to revisit some of my fun and funny and tragically, funnily dark experiences with you.
There you go. If we can't laugh at it though, then we just cry. And nobody wants to be around somebody that cries all day, every day. So
that's exactly right.
Do you ever look around your small town and feel like there's zero inspiration to be found? Well, I can totally relate to that. And yet I really truly believe that the best way to stay inspired is by choosing to find little easy ways to get those hits of inspiration. And that's why there's a whole section in the Small Town Survival Kit that includes wallpaper that I created with motivational, inspirational messages on them, including the books, the apps I use, and the podcasts that I listen to that make me feel like I'm not so small just because of my small environment. So grab the link and get your copy, because it really is all about the little things.